It's a pleasure to welcome you to the University of Illinois at Chicago, those of you who are not already here. A special welcome, of course, to our invited Philip Bowman Lecture, Dr. William Sandy Darity from Duke University. We are delighted to have you on our campus, and I'm very much looking forward to your lecture. I should also note that we have Philip Bowman himself here. Where did he go? There he is. And so we're delighted to have you here as well, Dr. Bowman. I want to also give a special welcome to the community leaders and members of Chicago civic organizations who are joining us this afternoon, as well, of course, as our UIC faculty, students, and staff. The Institute for Research on Race and Public Policy has a mission to increase society's understanding of the root causes of racial and ethnic inequality and to provide the public, organizers, practitioners, and policymakers with research-based policy solutions. The Institute was created in the 1990s to address the low representation of people of color throughout this university. It's been going strong now for over 20 years and has served the campus and the community as a place of intellectual inquiry, evidence-based research, and strategic thinking. Its current director, Dr. Amanda Lewis, has continued this legacy with her visionary and collaborative leadership. Now, maybe this has always been true, but it feels like now more than ever we need centers like the IRRPP to offer a community of scholars support for their intellectual endeavors around issues of race, to collaborate with community organizers on social justice projects, and to explore the relationship between policy and racial injustice. UIC has a deep and abiding commitment to the work of the IRRPP. We are, as our chancellor likes to say, not just the University of Illinois at Chicago, but the University of Illinois for Chicago. We cannot possibly fulfill that mission without long-term and sustained efforts that address the most important issues of our time and that leverage our collective skills in research and community outreach. Issues of race, justice, and public policy take their place at the top of our priorities at UIC. And I cannot emphasize this point better than by quoting the beginning and the end of a long poem by Langston Hughes, which I actually only learned about last week when it was quoted by the president of the ACLU who visited our campus. Hughes starts the poem this way: "Let America be America again. Let it be the dream it used to be. Let it be the pioneer on the plain seeking a home where he himself is free. America never was America to me." And he then has a long and beautiful poem, and he ends it this way: "Oh yes, I say it plain, America never was America to me, and yet I swear this oath, America will be." Now, the Institute for Research on Race and Public Policy is dedicated to understanding how we can create the America that was meant to be. There is no nobler cause and never has been in this country. So again, I want to thank you for being here, and I look forward to an interesting and engaging afternoon. Thanks.
Thank you so much. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Amanda Lewis, and I have the pleasure of being the director of the Institute for Research on Race and Public Policy, as well as being on the faculty here in Sociology and African American Studies. It is my great pleasure today to introduce our speaker for our annual Philip J. Bowman Lecture on Race, Ethnicity, and Public Policy. The Bowman Lecture focuses on providing timely analysis of issues of race, ethnicity, and justice facing us today. The lecture is named after the first permanent director of IRRPP, who does happen to be sitting right here, Philip J. Bowman, both because of his important leadership of the Institute and because of his prolific record as a scholar. All of us who have benefited from the work of IRRPP over the last 15 or 20 years owe a great debt of gratitude to Phil for his careful and strategic nurturance of this Institute at its beginning. He set a strong foundation that has enabled IRRPP to serve its mission of supporting UIC faculty and students, increasing the quantity, quality, and impact of research on race and policy at UIC, and serving as an important intellectual hub here in Chicago for cutting-edge research on race and ethnic dynamics that is deeply engaged not only with trying to understand, but to transform the conditions of underrepresented groups. Dr. Bowman is currently professor of higher education at the University of Michigan, where he's also director of the Diversity Research and Policy Program, as well as faculty associate for the Institute for Social Research and National Poverty Center. Dr. Bowman's scholarship focuses on racial and ethnic diversity, higher education, and related policy issues, including workforce opportunity, urban poverty, family distress, and health inequalities. He's also taking national leadership right now and pushing conversations about strengths-based interventions to reduce inequalities, disparities, and opportunity gaps. I am lucky to have known him for more than 20 years. He is often, I describe, the ultimate intellectual and scholar, mostly because he is just deeply and sincerely interested in the world, in people's stories, and in understanding why things are the way they are and how to transform them in ways to create more opportunity. Recently, I ran into yet another friend and colleague who had met Phil for the first time and sat down with him for what turned out to be a three-hour conversation. Those of you who know Phil know what I'm talking about, and gained more insights, they said, in that one conversation that they'd gotten in their entire graduate school career. Dr. Bowman operates with brilliance, great integrity, and skill, and we are very honored that he could be here with us today. Thanks very much for coming. The other asterisk to Phil is I keep trying to get his family here for this celebrate, but they're so overly accomplished, his children. So one of them just got a named professorship at Columbia last week, so they all had to go there for that. So next year, maybe they'll come here and join us for this. Our speaker today shares several qualities with Phil, as you'll notice when I get into the meat of my introduction. It is with great joy that I introduce William A. Sandy Darity, who is the Samuel DuBois Cook Professor of Public Policy, African and African American Studies and Economics, and the director of the Samuel DuBois Cook Center on Social Equity at Duke University. He has served as chair of the Department of African and African American Studies and was the founding director of the Research Network on Racial and Ethnic Inequality at Duke. He was most recently a fellow at the Russell Sage Foundation, but has also held prestigious fellowships at the Center for Advanced Study in the Behavioral Sciences at Stanford and at the National Humanities Center, and has been a visiting scholar at the Federal Reserve Board of Governors. In 2012, he received the Samuel Z. Westerfeld Award from the National Economic Association, the organization's highest honor. He is a past president of the National Economic Association, the Southern Economic Association, and as well, speaking to his wide reach and his deep interdisciplinary commitments, also it was the, I guess, past and current president of the Association of Black Sociologists. It's a long story. Dr. Darity has published or edited more than a dozen books and hundreds of articles in professional journals. Dr. Darity is also one of the most generous scholars I have known. He has done as much to help widen the pipeline for faculty of color into the academy as anyone I know. I can't tell you how many times I've been in conversation with a junior scholar, a postdoc, a graduate student somewhere, and Sandy's name comes up, and they say that he has read their paper or helped them get into graduate school, or that they attended some summer research mentoring program that he either ran or came to or helped fund, et cetera. He is not just one of the smartest people I know, and I must admit to taking some joy in seeing some otherwise very overly confident economists I know kind of become nervous in his presence, but one of the most grounded and engaged scholars I know. He's also a very talented blues musician, but I don't think he brought his harmonica with him today, so we'll have to wait till next visit. Oh, you have it? Okay. Anyway, I'm very excited to have him here today. I will now sit down so he can tell us about our work. He's going to be talking about some of the research from his forthcoming book on reparations. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Amanda. That's extraordinarily generous. I also want to say that it's my hope that my research center at Duke and IRRPP can develop a collaboration on, hopefully on a project trying to survey, to gain information about wealth differentials by race and ethnicity in Chicago, which we think, you know, needs to happen. I'd also like to thank Amanda's partner, Tyrone, for spending a year next door to me at Stanford and putting up with a variety of loud noises, especially music that came out of my office. And then I'd like to thank Phil Bowman. People frequently ask me who are my mentors? And at my age, there are very few of them remaining. But Phil Bowman is one, and one of the most important. One of the most important. He's one of the deepest scholars that I know, but he's also unusual because he is somebody who has excelled not only as a researcher, but as a university administrator at the highest levels. And so I'm very honored to be giving this lecture that is named after you. So thank you. So I'm working on a book called From Here to Equality with Kristen Mullen, who is my partner. And the book opens with a description of three objectives that are associated with reparations. In fact, we borrowed the phrase that Martin Luther King is famous for using, the arc of justice. And we borrowed that phrase because there are three components to reparations that fit nicely in the context of those terms. The first is the A is acknowledgement, the R is redress, and the C is closure. So by acknowledgement, what we mean is a reparations program is supposed to engage with a process of recognition and admission of the wrong by the perpetrators and or the beneficiaries of a major social injustice. The apology should take place, but the apology must be accompanied by a commitment for redress. So redress is the second component of a reparations project, and this can take two different forms. One form is atonement. So the perpetrators and or beneficiaries must meet conditions of forgiveness on the part of the victims. The victims must establish what the terrain is for forgiveness, and there should be good faith negotiations between those who are wronged and the wrongdoers, or the wrongdoing institution. Restitution, on the other hand, typically means the restoration of the survivors to the condition that they experienced prior to the injustice, or the position that they might have attained in the absence of the injustice. So restitution is somewhat different because then we have a metric that's based upon a presumed or imagined alternative state of affairs for the victimized population. And then closure means mutual reconciliation takes place, and there are no further claims made by the victim community for race-specific or group-specific programs. Indeed, no further claims will be made unless, of course, there's a new round of injustices. Okay. So those are the three components of a reparations program. And I'd like to take the next step in the conversation by exploring why we might have a reparations program. And unfortunately, in the context of thinking about reparations for Black Americans, there has been a nearly exclusive emphasis on slavery as the pertinent atrocity that justifies reparations. But I'd like to ask about the record of atrocities during the 150 years since slavery. Ta-Nehisi Coates's Resurrection of the Conversation about Reparations is particularly notable because Ta-Nehisi focuses on what happened after slavery. And indeed, he focuses heavily on what happened in the 20th century rather than the 19th century. So the focus of my conversation today is actually going to span the entire 150 years since slavery ended. And I'm going to try to make it clear that the unjust treatment of blacks in the United States is a national problem, and it always has been a national problem. This is one of the reasons that I wanted to give you this first slide, a Ku Klux Klan rally that's taking place on East Main Street in Ashland, Oregon in the 1920s. Now, Oregon has a peculiarly troubling history. Whites who migrated to the present-day state of Oregon during the 1840s and 1850s were typically against slavery, but they also were simultaneously against living with blacks. On September 21st, 1849, the territorial legislature passed a law that said, "It shall not be lawful for any Negro or mulatto to enter into or reside in Oregon." And in the preamble to the law, Negroes were disturbingly described as being likely to intermix with Indians, instilling into their minds feelings of hostility toward the white race. Now, I presume that the native population didn't have any independent reason for having some hostility toward the white race, but anyway. This clause, of course, was rendered moot by the 14th Amendment to the Constitution, but it was not actually repealed until 1926. And other infelicitous language, shall we say, was not removed from the state's official documents until 2002. Now, in the 1860 census, and this is just to indicate that this ordinance seems to have been fairly effective. In the 1860 census, there were 128 blacks in the population of 52,465 people in Oregon. In 2013, only 2% of the state's population is black. So we frequently heard references to sundown towns. These are towns where, if you're black, you better be out of town before the sun goes down. I've also used that concept metaphorically to describe academic departments that have never had a black faculty member. So I call them sundown departments, okay? But Oregon functioned as a sundown state. Okay, so this is particularly striking. Not in the South, not in the Northeast, but in the far west of the United States, we have Oregon. Let me see. So the first phase of oppression that's associated with the post-slavery period is the failure to fulfill the promise of 40 acres and a mule to families who had been enslaved. Had that promise been made, had the ex-slaves been given a substantial endowment in Southern real estate, it is likely that there would be no need for reparations to be under consideration today. The 40 acres were to be allocated roughly to families of four. Therefore, each ex-slave should have received 10 acres of land. Since there were 4 million ex-slaves, a total of 40 million acres of land should have been allocated to formerly enslaved blacks. Now, while 40 acres was small compared against many American slave plantations, it would have been a substantial allotment. In 2013, the median American home was located on 8,596 square feet of land, or 0.2 acres. Therefore, on average, 200 residences could have been built on the typical tract of land that should have been distributed to the ex-slaves. It would have made it possible for descendants of the enslaved to have sold significant property at a high price to developers, or to have become developers themselves, or to have created other innovative commercial uses for their property. While the allocation of 40 acres was not made, black American farmers managed to amass 16 to 19 million acres of land by dint of their own efforts by 1910. Still less than half of the amount the ex-slaves should have received during Reconstruction, but not insubstantial. This was the peak of land ownership by black farmers in the United States, with 218,000 farmers as full or partial owners. By 1997, black farm land ownership had diminished to a mere 2.4 million acres. Today, the top five white landowners in the United States own more land than the whole of black America. And apparently, Ted Turner alone owns more than the equivalent of one quarter of the entire acreage of land in the possession of black Americans. The record of black land loss has not been one of voluntary sales at market prices. The land African Americans lost over the 20th century was taken in some form and not sold freely. As Thomas Pinnock and Gray report, in many instances, black land literally was seized in a climate of white terror, and their findings are based upon an investigation that was conducted early in the 21st century. Now, the failure to grant the ex-slaves an initial stake in American property ownership and subsequent sustained land taking from blacks has contributed to the comprehensive denial of black wealth accumulation. Apart from the barriers to land ownership, black home ownership was restricted by discriminatory redlining, differential access to government finance for home mortgages, and most recently by the subprime mortgage crisis engendered by loan pushing by the banking system. By 2013, data from the Federal Reserve Survey of Consumer Finances indicates that white median wealth or net worth is 15 times greater than black median wealth or net worth. Now, not only were blacks not given the promised 40 acres and a mule after the Civil War ended, but a white terror campaign that included assassinations of black elected officials, freedmen, and their white allies throughout the South prevented blacks from exercising their right to vote. Black state senator and prominent delegate to the post-Civil War South Carolina Constitutional Convention, Benjamin F. Randolph, a staunch advocate of black suffrage and education, and the publisher and co-editor of the Charleston Advocate, a newspaper for freedmen, was executed by the Ku Klux Klan at a train depot in Hodges, South Carolina in 1868. The Klan also executed white North Carolina State Senator John W. Stevens in a courthouse in Yanceyville in 1870. Stevens had been a member of both the Republican Party and the Union League. A former Confederate, Stevens' efforts to organize blacks in Caswell County, North Carolina, obviously inflamed the white supremacists. The impressions of Union Colonel Samuel Thomas in 1865 exposed the depth of white disdain for black political rights and black life after slavery's end. Colonel Samuel Thomas, the assistant commissioner of the Freedmen's Bureau, who opened the bureau office in Vicksburg, noticed white Mississippians' defiant posture when he traveled throughout the state months after the war. "Wherever I go, the street, the shop, the house, or the steamboat, I hear the people talk in such a way as to indicate that they are yet unable to conceive of the Negro as possessing any rights at all." Thomas worried that whites who are honorable in their dealings with their white neighbors will cheat a Negro without feeling a single twinge of their honor. To kill a Negro, they do not deem murder. Such men openly boasted to Thomas that blacks will catch hell when local whites reacquired political control. Trying to explain this defiance, Thomas pointed to prejudices seared into white minds and hearts during the era of slavery. As Thomas put it, though white Mississippians admit that the individual relations of masters and slaves have been destroyed by the war and the President's Emancipation Proclamation, they still have an ingrained feeling that the blacks at large belong to the whites at large. These attitudes produced the conditions for an intense and systematic level of white supremacist political violence throughout the states of the former Confederacy. This was particularly true in the states where Republican Party dominance persisted as late as 1874, almost a decade after the end of the war: Louisiana, Florida, South Carolina, and Mississippi. In the big three states of Mississippi, South Carolina, and Louisiana, Negro voters were so deeply entrenched that nothing short of a full-scale revolution could dislodge them. Southern Democrats were up to the demands of that hour. The white population organized for war. The Negro population at the same time was systematically disarmed by hook and crook. On any and every pretext, the homes of Negroes were searched and arms were systematically appropriated. By 1876, when Union troops were removed entirely from the southern states, the die was cast. With rare exceptions, the right to vote was quashed for blacks, leading Leroy Bennett to conclude in an old issue of Ebony Magazine, "Soon the Civil War would be sucked of all meaning and would become an agency of reconciliation between the North and South." Preceded by the adoption of the Black Codes, laws that limited black mobility and black legal rights, by 1818.
Okay.
White supremacists regained control of most of the legislatures in the former states of the Confederacy, and then in a perverse interpretation of the 14th Amendment, the Supreme Court's Plessy versus Ferguson decision found that separate but equal met the test for equal protection under the law. So the system of American apartheid was not deemed officially illegal until passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. political intimidation, witness here. Okay. Click on this. Okay. Aha. Thank you. Political intimidation, economic exclusion, and the erasure of communities where blacks had attained some measure of affluence were the customary aims of a wave of massacres conducted by whites from the 1870s well into the 1940s. Among the very earliest in the post-Civil War period were the Memphis Riot of 1866, the brutal attacks conducted by the White League in Colfax and Coushatta in Louisiana. And in the case of Coushatta, Louisiana, we actually had a municipal coup d'etat in which the elected public officials who were affiliated with the Republican Party were systematically executed by the revolutionaries. The White Riot in Danville, Virginia took place in 1883, followed by an even more destructive bloodbath that took place 2 years after Plessy, the 1898 massacre in Wilmington, North Carolina. Planned in advance and systematically encouraged by white supremacist agitation, the goal of the Wilmington massacre was the overthrow of the Republican elected municipal government. The plotters were drawn from the best social class of the city's white people, most visibly including Alfred Waddell, a former Confederate Army colonel who installed himself as mayor after the uprising. In all of these cases, local police forces were deeply implicated as agents of violence and extermination directed against blacks. White supremacists who fomented the Atlanta riot that took place in 1906 and led to dozens of black deaths patterned their vigilante assault after the tactics pursued by the conspirators in Wilmington. In 1917, East St. Louis, Illinois was engulfed by destruction, and in the aftermath of World War I and the Bolshevik Revolution, the grisly red summer of 1919 witnessed murderous assaults on black communities in dozens of towns and cities, including Elaine, Arkansas, Chicago, Illinois, Washington, D.C., Norfolk, Virginia, Omaha, Nebraska, Charleston, South Carolina, and Bisbee, Arizona. Perhaps the most horrific massacre took place in Tulsa, Oklahoma in 1921, which resulted in the complete destruction of the prosperous black Greenwood community, a so-called Black Wall Street, and included the dropping of incendiary devices on black homes and businesses. The white riot depicted in the 1997 film Rosewood took place in 1923 in a small town of the same name, but the white violence in Rosewood was only one of many instances in the bloody state of Florida during the first two decades of the 20th century. Murderous assaults by white soldiers attacking black soldiers often took place on military bases, and the assaults intensified when black soldiers retaliated by defending themselves. Throughout the 20th century, America was characterized by a long and extensive lynching trail. And this lynching trail, I guess the most recent estimates place the number of blacks murdered by white gangs and mobs between 1877 and 1950 at close to 4,000 in the states of Alabama, Arkansas, and the remaining states of the old Confederacy. Kentucky, the only one among the states that are included in these estimates where enslaved persons represented less than 25% of its overall population, was the only state among these that did not secede from the Union. And these numbers for lynchings of blacks do not include approximately 300 more that took place outside of the South. And then occasionally, these lynching frenzies overlapped with the white massacres. For example, 237 blacks were lynched in Elaine, Arkansas during the 1919 white riot. At times, lynchings also were associated directly with the expropriation of black-owned land, and the threat of lynching also created a climate of intimidation that promoted black subordination. So in June 20, 13, 2005, the US Senate passed a resolution apologizing for not passing an anti-lynching bill. Okay. Yeah. So the ongoing destruction of comparatively affluent black communities no longer is achieved via white riots, but by a more subtle form of violence. First, urban renewal, and second, gentrification. Both processes have been described sarcastically as Negro removal. Black neighborhoods produced under the constraints imposed by white preference for residential segregation often develop stable middle-income communities and black-owned business districts. Nevertheless, these Jim Crow neighborhoods still have been subjected to demolition. For example, and I want to elaborate on this particular case because it's quite interesting. It's Memphis, Tennessee. In 1953, Memphis had a middle-income black community that was declared a slum to justify its demolition, including the symbolically significant burning of the former home of a prominent black community leader named Robert Church at 384 South Lauderdale Streets. The community's black residents had protested this decision to no avail. Residents beseeched Senator McKellar, their one-time neighbor and a conduit of federal authority, not to wreck this whole section of the city, as one letter put it. The homeowners are sick and distressed beyond measure. They wrote that they had toiled for years to pay off their mortgages and fix up their properties, and they'd succeeded in making this the best neighborhood for blacks in Memphis. Their community was more valuable than any relocation funds the city might provide. One of E.H. Boss Crump's leading black organizers, the Reverend T.O. Fuller, protested that he'd lose his home, workplace, and church. Okay, so Boss Crump was the mayor of the city. And so even one of his closest allies felt threatened by this set of steps. Their grievances, however, were ignored. The Memphis Housing Authority, established in the mid-1930s, part of the wave of local authorities begun under Roosevelt's New Deal, leveled a 46-acre area and replaced the single-family homes with a low-rise, 900-unit public housing complex. The federal interstate program, highway program, also was deployed to situation new freeways that ran through the heart of black communities, disrupting established neighborhoods, displacing residents, and destroying black-owned business districts. Raymond Moll's 2002 report for the Poverty and Race Research Action Council identified city after city, both north and south, east and west, where black communities were shattered by the location and construction of federal highways in their midst. And this is one of the cities in which the black community was bisected by a federal highway, Overtown, Florida. Some of you have seen the recent movie that won the Academy Award, right? Yeah, Moonlight. Well, Moonlight is essentially set in contemporary Overtown. I think they refer to it by a slightly different name, but it's the same community. Okay. So here we have the other dimension of this process, which is the use of segregation in public places as a means of maintaining distance and also subjecting blacks to indignities. I think it's a little tricky here to determine whether or not this type of separate water fountain phenomenon is a microaggression or a macroaggression. but let's say that if we think of macroaggressions as the form of assaults that threaten life and limb, you're only threatened with life by life and limb if you try to drink at the white water fountain. Okay, so. So maybe we can call this a microaggression, but it's obviously quite severe. And if we think about a cumulative set of these, we can understand how we might have an erosion of spirit and health as a consequence of this. One of the things that we observe today is very, very high rates of hypertension among African Americans. And I think we're increasingly compelled to explain those rates of hypertension in large part by the degree of racialized stress that blacks are confronted with. And so if we think about the Jim Crow period, that's a period in which there's a paramount level of racialized stress that's being imposed by the operation of the dual social system, as well as, and this is what I want to come to next, the dual educational system. So if we think of devaluation of black lives as a direct product of public policy, one of those profound dimensions of devaluation is the maintenance of separate and unequal schools. The formal structure of Jim Crow, schooling did not end, and this is the formal structure, until 1954 with the U.S. Supreme Court's Brown versus Board decision. The pursuit of massive resistance to the court's decision by the states of the old Confederacy meant that genuine school desegregation really did not get underway until the early 1970s. Okay. The dual school system ensured racial differences in the quality of school facilities, in teacher compensation per pupil, and in the quality of instructional materials. The magnitude of these disparities first were documented carefully by Horace Mann Bond in his classic study, The Education of the Negro in the American Social Order. And Horace Mann Bond was Julian Bond's daddy. And so, and he was a major scholar who investigated the history of education in the United States. In his classic study, he detailed the widespread practice of paying black teachers significantly less than white teachers. Frequently under the dual system, the black-white ratio of teacher salaries was 60% or lower. Nor could these huge disparities in teacher pay be explained fully by differences in teacher training. Economic historian Robert Margot has estimated that both in 1910 and 1940, about 80% of the difference in black and white teacher pay was due to sheer racial differences in compensation established on pay schedules by local white-dominated school boards. This was out-and-out discrimination. School segregation also provided an avenue for the systematic fulfillment of the desire expressed by Reconstruction-era white supremacists, President Andrew Johnson, who was probably the worst president America has ever had. I know there's some competition now, but Andrew Johnson is clearly a horrible, horrible president. Okay, so Andrew Johnson was inclined to uplift the Negro, but he wanted to do so in such a way that you maintained a fixed educational gap between blacks and whites. So he said, according to the Cincinnati Inquirer, Johnson wrote to Governor Thomas C. Fletcher of Missouri, "This is a country for white men, and by God, as long as I am president, it shall be a government for white men." Now, whether the paper quoted him correctly cannot be determined with certainty, but he did make his racial views perfectly clear to Benjamin B. French, the commissioner of public buildings, in the following statement: "Everyone would and must admit that the white race was superior to the black, and that while we ought to do our best to bring them up to our present level, that in doing so we should at the same time raise our own intellectual status so that the relative position of the two races will be the same." Okay. Johnson's objective of maintaining relatively inferior education for blacks has been sustained in the post-Brown versus Board era. De facto segregation of schools attributable to school assignment plans and residential segregation, coupled with grossly unequal allocations of resources to black schools, has continued to the present day in many urban areas. And at least as pernicious are patterns of within-school segregation that result in the assignment of black students to the least challenging and engaging curricula and instruction. Racialized tracking is the culprit. Indeed, teachers, particularly white teachers who function as the primary gatekeepers in gifted identification programs, are less likely to refer black students for gifted programs than white students with similar levels of academic achievement. The persistence of wage and employment discrimination and wealth inequality ensures that America's die are loaded against blacks in two ways. Not only do black Americans have reduced opportunities to obtain quality education, there is also less of a payoff for any credential they earn. At each level of educational attainment, blacks have an unemployment rate two times as high as that of whites. Blacks with some college education or an associate's degree typically have a higher unemployment rate than whites who never finished high school. job prospects for recent black college graduates, including those with degrees in engineering, remain comparatively grim. Racial differences in earnings for MBA recipients from the same schools grow to enormous levels over a short span in time. For example, black MBAs from the Harvard Business School start their post-degree careers earning $5,000 less than their white peers. Within 6 to 8 years of graduation, the racial pay differential approaches $100,000. Bloomberg data demonstrates that the industry in which pay is most inequitable by race and gender is finance. Tony business schools like Harvard's, Columbia's, and the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania send the largest proportion of their graduates to the financial sector. A recent audit study of more than 1,000 positions advertised on a national job search website using racialized names is especially revealing. Despite the fact that a credential from an elite, highly selective university improves the employer response rate, white candidates from less selective schools received as strong a response rate as blacks from more selective schools. In addition, when employers did respond, they offered black candidates lower initial salaries and lower status position than white candidates with comparable or even inferior educational credential. Moreover, blacks with a college degree have a mere two-thirds of the median net worth held by whites who never finished high school. Blacks who are working full-time have a lower median net worth than whites who are unemployed. So, I also want to talk about the abuse of black lives. And, you know, when the Black Lives Matter movement came forward, the depth of the resonance of that phrase was quite profound for someone like me who had been thinking about the entire historical pattern of the disregard for black lives. And that's the key point. It's not a suggestion that other people's lives don't matter. The point is that historically the United States has treated black lives systematically as if they do not matter. And here's another instance. This instance is associated with the use of black lives for the purposes of medical experimentation. And here we have an image from the notorious Tuskegee experiment, where black men were left untreated for syphilis for 40 years so that investigators could, in their words, observe the progression of the disease. And Alondra Nelson, so this is a certificate that was distributed to all the surviving participants in 1958. And even at this stage, where they receive a certificate applauding them for their participation in the project, they still were not told that they had a disease for which they were being observed and not treated. So that's by 1958. And then we finally have in 1997, President Bill Clinton issuing a formal apology for the Tuskegee study. But of course, it's once again, it's a case of an apology. Remember I said that acknowledgement requires not only the apology, but the commitment to engage in redress. So, the last thing that I want to make mention of in this context is forced sterilization. So, black families also have been prevented from reproducing by involuntary sterilizations, both officially under state eugenics programs and unofficially by coercive physicians who insist that performing hysterectomies on black women who are recipients of welfare payments is fully justified. Eugenic sterilization programs were adopted in 30 states and resulted in the sterilization of upwards of 60,000 persons between the 1930s and 1970s. The states of California and North Carolina in particular disproportionately sterilized their black residents. And in my state of North Carolina, the state eugenics program was not formally ended until 1972. The use of involuntary sterilization to curb black fertility also was evident in a pattern. in the 1960s and 1970s of physicians denying black female welfare recipients medical services unless they agreed to have their tubes tied. So black lives have not mattered in the United States since the end of slavery. And indeed, some people might say that black lives might have been valued a bit more under slavery. American society has marked down the value of black well-being for a century and a half. And I've attempted to share the documentation for many of the aspects of this process of devaluation in our book, from our book chapter in the conversation today. The catalog of injustices listed here are sufficient for making the case for reparations, quite apart from the evil of slavery itself. And the pattern of the elimination of black lives in a direct and physical and violent way continues in the form of police lynchings of blacks. And this is the case of Eric Garner that's depicted here. When the United Nations Working Group of Experts on People of African Descent issued their dramatic report calling for reparations for black Americans in 2016, they emphasized current injustices as well as enslavement and the long-term effects of enslavement. As the Washington Post reported, in particular, the legacy of colonial histories, enslavement, racial subordination and segregation, racial terrorism and racial inequality in the United States remains a serious challenge, as there has been no real commitment to reparations and to truth and reconciliation for people of African descent, the report stated. Contemporary police killings and the trauma that they create are reminiscent of the past racial terror of lynching. I would go further. I would say they're exactly analogous to the past racial terror of lynching. Citing the past year's spate of police officers killing unarmed African American men, the UN panel warned against impunity for state violence, which has created, in its words, a human rights crisis that must be addressed as a matter of urgency. And indeed, the crisis that that we are continuing to confront in the United States is not something that has evolved overnight. It has a long and sustained history. It could have been interrupted in Reconstruction by giving blacks full right to political participation in the United States and by providing the ex-slaves with property throughout the South. Neither of those things took place, and we are reaping the consequences of America's failure to become a true democracy. Okay, so the question is, what would this look like if we actually inaugurate a reparations program? So I'm going to be a little slippery here, because one of the features of our new book is a chapter that's going to detail how we would do a reparations program. So I don't want to give everything away here. I do want people to try to get the book at some point. Okay, it's my entrepreneurial instincts kicking in. Okay, so. But I can answer at least one of those questions, which is who would be eligible. And this is going to be somewhat provocative to folks, but I think that eligibility would be contingent on individuals possessing two characteristics. The first characteristic is that they would have to be descended from somebody who had been enslaved in the United States. And the second characteristic is, for up to 10 years prior to the onset of the reparations program, they would have had to have self-identified as black, Negro, colored, or African American. Okay, and of course the second condition is one to prevent people from jumping in and declaring that they are black once reparations is potentially available to them. Okay, so that's So that's the first thing. So the second question you asked is how much. And there's an immense section of the book that's on the magnitude of how we might estimate a reparations program. But in some of my previous work, I've focused primarily on the question of what is the present value of 40 acres and a mule. And if that had been allocated in 1866 or 1865, what would be the equivalent value of that amount of land today? And that could be a foundation or a jumping off point for constructing a full estimate of what the relevant sum of money will be. People frequently say that there's no way you can pay people for the injustices of slavery or the injustices of lynching. But you know, where there are harms done to other folks in American society, we typically go to the courts and come up with some monetary estimate. And this strikes me as absolutely no different. There should be compensation. Some people argue that this reinforces a victim mentality, but I think that victims never get well until the perpetrators actually acknowledge what they have done to the victims and attempt in some way to compensate them. So I view the process of reparations as a mechanism for producing healing. Yes. Yeah, that's a great question. The question was, do I see the largest factor in explaining the kinds of inequalities that we observe today with respect to wealth as the inequalities generally being associated with the lack of accumulation of wealth? And so my answer is yes. And my answer is yes in particular because I depart from the view that the major source of wealth is a series of acts of personal savings. Okay, so I mean, I think this is the American mythos that, you know, most of us generate these substantial sums of wealth by just being very deliberate and precise about our savings activity out of whatever income we get. What I think is the primary source of wealth are transfers of resources across generations. Okay, and these intergenerational transfers take a couple of forms. One is inheritances, where the transfers occur when the donor dies. But the other form is one that we don't think about so much. In economics, we use the jargon of describing these as in vivo transfers, which is just a fancy way of saying these are transfers that take place while the donors are still living. Another term we could use to describe these are gifts. Okay. And essentially, intergenerational gifts are an important source of the opportunity to accumulate wealth for the next generation. Some examples might be the fact that parents might help their sons and daughters with the expenses associated with their college education. Another might be parents providing their son and daughter on graduation with an automobile. Okay? I'm not sure that that's happened particularly on a frequent basis to UIC students, but I know it happens to Duke students. Okay. And in addition, you know, parents might assist a son or daughter, or they might assist a son or daughter with making the down payment on a home, or they might even give them a home under some circumstances. So, these are the key ways in which people accumulate wealth, is that they start with some foundation that gives them an advantage or a springboard towards the acquisition of additional wealth. So my answer to your question is, if we look at racial differences in wealth, the primary source of those racial differences in wealth is the differential in the capacity of white parents to transfer significant sums of resources to their kids that black parents are not able to do. And the reason why black parents are not able to do it is embedded fully in the conversation that I've just had with you about what has happened historically in the United States. Mark? Okay. So the narrative that many people have about wealth accumulation is you get additional education. That will lead you to have a higher income, and that makes it possible for you to save more, and therefore you can have a higher level of wealth. Okay. Well, I'm not going to deny that that path is not there. But it's not a very important path in terms of the accumulation of significant amounts of wealth. And one of the statistics that I shared with you earlier is one that I think really reinforces the limitations of that path. And that statistic is the one where I said that blacks with a college degree typically have two-thirds of the net worth of whites who never finished high school. And that two-thirds is approximately $20,000, where the white net worth for non-high school graduates at the median is $30,000. So it's a $10,000 differential between folks who have college degrees and folks who never completed high school. And I think that that's a real demonstration of the phenomenon of racial privilege also. People frequently ask, well, why does the white working class not defect and side with the black masses? Well, this is one reason, that there are certain concrete and material advantages to being white. And the other one that's really significant is in terms of your interaction with the police. Okay, so these kinds of wealth differentials that exist despite relatively high levels of educational attainment on the part of blacks are indicative of why the human capital to savings story really is not an adequate one. So one of the issues for me always has been the question of whether or not you could successfully implement a program of reparations with massive white resistance. And of course, I don't think you can. And I've not been an advocate of trying to introduce reparations through judicial action. I've always argued that reparations is something that should be legislated at the federal level, that Congress has to do it. And so for us to reach a point where Congress would actually enact a reparations program, there would have had to have been a significant sea change in the attitudes of whites in the United States. And hopefully that would mean that we would no longer be in an environment in which structural racism was something that appears to be impregnable. So for us to actually have a reparations program, there would have to be a change in attitude. And I think that that change in attitude is something that is possible. It is possible particularly, I believe, in terms of the attitudes of younger Americans rather than folks who are in my age group. And I've put an estimate out there that we would need to get to a point, a tipping point, where about 40% of Americans in the United States, white Americans, would be in support of reparations for it to be something that could be actionable. At the moment, the estimate is closer to 20%, but then some of you may be familiar with Michael Dawson's work that he did with Ravana Popoff in the early 1990s, where about 4% of whites in the United States were in favor of reparations for black Americans. So one might say that there's some evidence of progress there, but we would need to get to the 40% threshold for it to be realistic. And then we might also be in an environment where we could think about really maintaining a serious assault on structural racism at the same time. Yeah, it's a great question. Yeah, so the judicial route is something that's been pursued by people like Deirdre Farmer Paleman, which is to bring lawsuits against individual corporations. You could bring a lawsuit against the federal government, which is a tricky issue to some degree. The corporations out is an obvious one, particularly if the lawsuit is built on slavery, which is that slavery was illegal in the United States. And it remained legal up until the Civil War, because if you think about it, the Fugitive Slave Act was a national piece of legislation. So slavery was, in that sense, mandated as legal nationally as a consequence of the existence of those types of laws. So so the corporations can always say, well, it was legal. I mean, you know, it wasn't a good thing we did, but you know, it wasn't against the law. So so I think that the case has to be directed against the federal government, which is the agency that maintained the legality of slavery, and also is the unit that has maintained the historic conditions that we've described here that include the use of some federal policies in a very explicit way for the purposes of destroying not only black property, but also black lives. The question was, in the absence of formal and informal networks, how much does wealth really matter? Okay, so. So one of the people who was a ferocious opponent of reparations is former President Barack Obama. Okay. But Barack Obama actually received an inheritance of approximately $500,000 from his grandmother, his white grandmother. Okay. But he's opposed to reparations for black Americans in general. Okay. I'm not so sure how important it is what networks you have. If you have a working sum of money of $500,000 to play with as a 21-year-old, okay, so my answer to you is no, I don't think it's a big deal. Give me the money. I don't care about the networks. I'll buy my networks.
Yeah,
so actually, I don't want to go too far on down this road because there's an entire section of the book that's on both of those points. The question was, how do you respond to the neoliberal argument that blacks have already received reparations in the form of entitlement programs and also in the form of affirmative action? Okay, it's a standard argument, yeah. The first point is, with respect to the entitlement programs, that blacks were denied access to the entitlement programs for upwards of 30 years, that when they were first inaugurated under the New Deal era, they were designed and structured in such a way that blacks would not have significant access to those programs so that the Southern Democrats would actually support the New Deal. Okay. So blacks don't really get significant access to these entitlement programs until the mid-1960s. So that's the first point. These programs were not designed for black folks, and in fact, they were intentionally designed to exclude black folks at the beginning of their their instantiation. But the second thing is that those are programs that are predicated on individuals having to fall into despair. That is, you have to become poor before you become eligible for those programs. So you have to be exposed to poverty before you can have access to those programs. And the premise behind reparations is we are supposed to be engaging in some sense in a form of repair for past and ongoing harm. And so that's quite different philosophically and substantively from entitlement programs, which are supposed to help people out on a means-tested basis. Okay, so that's the entitlement one. The second one on affirmative action is I have long argued that affirmative action cannot be philosophically viewed as a form of reparations. Affirmative action is an anti-discrimination measure. And it should complement anti-discrimination laws that require you to go to court to bring suits against perpetrators. This is very different, again, from a notion of structuring a program that is supposed to be compensating people for a harm a past harm or an ongoing harm. So this is very substantively different. So I would argue that affirmative action is not designed to, never was designed to, or never was intended to be a reparations program. And so I don't see them as substitutes. And I think there's Ross Dutat or somebody like that just proposed that give Black Americans $10,000 and Black Americans could then agree to eliminate affirmative action. Yeah, this is like a few days ago. But what's interesting is, and maybe Dutat doesn't know this himself, but Charles Krauthammer proposed exactly the same deal in 2001 and actually offered a little more money than Dutat. But that's getting off cheap. So the question is, how would I respond to the notion that Barack Obama's election as Black president indicates that racism is over? So I mean, one easy response is the most recent election. but a tougher response is the following one. There's an important distinction that can be made between affective and cognitive attitudes towards members of an outside social group. Okay, so by affective attitudes, I mean the capacity for you to feel warmth or friendship with individuals who are from an out social group. This is in contrast with the cognitive beliefs you might have about members of that group, where the cognitive beliefs might include the perception that the group collectively is inferior. So it's possible for you to identify individuals from the out group who appear to be exceptional and who you might even support or endorse while still feeling that the out group collectively is inferior. And this could be reinforced by the kinds of messages that are delivered by the individuals who are members of the out-group when they are in positions of authority or influence. And if you think about it very carefully, you can really recollect the number of times where Barack Obama invoked the notion that Blacks are engaged in dysfunctional behavior, and that explains why we observe many of the disparities that we do. You know, you need to pull up your pants, the pookie speeches. I mean, the litany is really quite disturbing. So in want of full disclosure, I did do an article for the Atlantic. I had an interview for the Atlantic about the Trump administration, and obviously that's pretty scathing. But I also had an article that was in the Atlantic called How Barack Obama Failed Black America. And so I know I'm in Chicago and I'm probably not supposed to say these sorts of things here, but you may want to take a look at that article, because one of the critical points I make is that it really was unfortunate that we had the first Black president of the United States evoking many of the same tropes that are used by white supremacists to explain why Blacks have a lower status in the United States. And I think that, you know, the presentation today is an attempt to craft a narrative that tells a very, very different story about how we came to be where we are today. And that narrative has to do with white violence, coercion, and the like.
Yeah.
Well, but my acknowledge my sense of, oh, he didn't have anything to do with that. My sense of acknowledgement has two components, as I said. One is the apology. The other is the commitment for redress. Congress did issue an apology for slavery. It has not issued an apology for the entire litany. Yeah, yeah, that did occur. Yeah. But there was no commitment made to engage in redress. Yeah, and so that's the problem. Yeah, so this is a question about the global strategy for reparations and the role of some of the Caribbean nations trying to pursue reparations. So none of them have received reparations. And in fact, I think one of the British prime ministers said, we're gonna send you back the folks who are in our jails. Donated prison to Jamaica when this issue of black reparations was raised. So those countries have not received reparations. More power to them. I'm all in favor of their efforts to pursue reparations, but I'm not sure. I think we need to have a mutual conversation among all the potential claimants, because I'm not sure that either one of us can learn something from the other without there being some reciprocal learning, because none of the countries have received reparations thus far. And so, I would argue that the nations on the African continent have a systematic case for reparations about the existence of colonialism and imperialism that was directed toward them. Now, you know, whether or not any of the current generations of African leaders are inclined to take such a step is probably, I don't know, I'm skeptical. But I am glad to see that the Caribbean nations are trying to pursue this issue. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. So I think that's a critical question. The question is about the position of land rights and land access and how central that is, but it's not really something that's emphasized. Particularly by black leadership today, and there's actually two ways to think about that, and some of this is actually quite relevant to the Native American experience. So one way you can think about it is you actually do engage in turning over the land to those to whom it is owed. Okay. And that's a very dramatic step. One of the organizations that you mentioned that's been advocates of land access is the Republic of New Africa, which, as you said, is one that doesn't have a high profile or a high degree of credibility. But what they really ask—that's right, another. Yeah, and what they've really been asking for is basically, at least the Republic of New Africa, is control over the 11 states of the South, of the old South, right. So we might reach the conclusion that it's unlikely that this land is going to get turned over. But what we may be able to get is the rough equivalent to the value of it. Okay. So I've not talked so much about the direct transfer of land as I have talked about the direct transfer of the equivalent monetary value of that land. And that's why I said my starting point frequently is thinking about the value of 40 acres and a mule today. But yeah, that's a critical question. And it doesn't necessarily have to be land that is productive per se. I mean, there's not much farmland on Manhattan. But I think any one of us would be very pleased.
So I want to go back to your optimism about the legislative process and newer generations. And how do you think that, sort of the macro trends of inequality and inequality and this experience of the past and the possibility of future regulations? I mean, in the sense that,
so could everybody hear that question? No, I'll try again. So I interpret Marcus's question as what's the effect on my optimistic read about the potential for the younger generation to support reparations given the increasing degree of inequality that we're experiencing in American society today? To what extent would younger people necessarily be in favor of reparations for Black Americans if they're feeling that they themselves are being deprived? Okay. So my response is, and I Marcus, you probably can guess how I might respond, is that reparations is not the only thing I'm in favor of, okay? And in fact, in my ideal world, there would be three major social policies. One would be reparations for African Americans. The second would be the provision of a federal job guarantee for all citizens. And the third would be the introduction of a program that Derek Hamilton at the New School and I have referred to as the baby bonds proposal. It's not really a bond. The idea is that the federal government would provide each newborn infant, so it's a universal program, it's not specific to African Americans, each newborn infant with a trust fund or an endowment. So, rich folks give their kids trust funds. Why shouldn't every child in the United States receive a trust fund? And this trust fund would be staggered in amount based upon the wealth level of the child's family. So if a kid is from the wealthiest families in the United States, we'd give them a $50 trust fund. Okay. But for kids who are from families at the bottom end of the wealth distribution, we'd give them a $50,000 or $60,000 trust fund. And what this would do is it would go a long way to breaking the relationships between parental status and parental resources and the resources that are available to the next generation. So I see that as a universal program. It's a program that probably should be adopted in concert with a reparations program, because the reparations program in some sense is trying to the best extent possible to wipe the slate clean with respect to racial inequality. But it does not eliminate all inequalities or all significant or unfair inequalities. And so something like the baby bonds proposal could do that. And I think if we had a package of social programs that would really transform the way in which our economic lives are lived, we would be in a better position to say, okay, please come forward and support us on the reparations program also. So that's the idea I have, is that you would need reparations in conjunction with it, at least these other two social policies. The other one I rarely talk about, but I'm going to more and more, is public banking. But I'll hold on that one. Yeah, well, I do want to be a little bit careful here, because I don't view the type of aid that's being provided to Israel by the United States today as a form of reparations. So I just want to be careful about that. There was a reparations program, as you know, that was conducted by the German government. And the German government's reparations program had two dimensions. One dimension was the provision of reparations to people who had been subjected to the Nazi Holocaust, but the other dimension was the provision of resources to the State of Israel itself. So at the beginning of Israel's existence as an independent state, there was the provision of a significant amount of resources that came from the German government, and that was a reparations program. I don't believe the United States has ever had anything that we could formally call a reparations program for Israel. So the question we may want to raise is whether or not the type of foreign aid that's been provided to Israel is justified, but I don't think we can parallel that with the provision of reparations. The only significant other case of reparations in the United States at the national level that I'm aware of, apart from some people saying that there are forms of things that have been done for Native Americans which are reparations, I personally don't accept that, is the reparations program that was enacted for to address the incarceration of Japanese Americans during World War II. That's the only other true reparations program that has been enacted in the United States. And that was an odd program, because it provided the Japanese Americans who had been incarcerated and who were still living at the time with $20,000 apiece. So it was almost like a Dutout or Krauthammer kind of deal, because the amounts were so very low. And the numbers of Japanese Americans are much, much smaller than the numbers of African Americans, so that the total bill was not very large. Okay, so this is in the chapter on how to do it. but let me say this. Ever since the U.S. government turned $1.6 billion over to the investment banking community, I don't know how anybody asks, how are we going to pay for this? Okay, so that's semi-facetious, but it's actually a serious point. If they hadn't done that, then we could still play this game about how we're going to pay for things. But they did that, and you could arrive at a total bill for reparations. You could design the program in such a way that you had what we might call a portfolio of reparations, so that part of the reparations package would constitute a check that would go to eligible Black Americans. But another part might be resources that are devoted to various kinds of institution building. But you also could stagger the amounts of payment, so that if you perceive that the total bill was something that was intractably large to be done at one moment in time, then you could design it so that you laid it out over a period of 10 or 15 years or something like that. So I don't think that the issue of financing it is one that is an impossible barrier. Yes.
How are you?
So let me start with the easier piece of my response, and then I'll come to the piece that always makes people upset. So the easier piece of my response is the following, that much of my thinking has been wrapped up in thinking about the nation state as the target site for making the claim. And so From my perspective, then, if you take that as a given, and if you don't, we can talk about it. But it's the Black American population that has to direct their claim at the U.S. government. It's the various Caribbean communities that have to direct their claims at the colonial powers that control their territories. As far as I can tell, Haiti still has a huge claim on France. If anything, it was Haiti that paid France, which is, to me is just a staggeringly amazing chain of events, okay. But similarly, the countries that were subjected to colonialism should be directing their claims against the former colonial powers. Countries like Portugal and Belgium, from my point of view, have huge debts to pay. Okay, so I start with the nation state, and then I say that different communities of Black folks around the diasporized world need to make sure that they identify the relevant nation state that should be the target for their claim. Okay, that's the easier part of my discussion. Here's the hard part. So. Yeah, the eligibility criteria that I presented intentionally exclude individuals who do not have ancestry in the United States. And one of the reasons is the following. I do not believe it is appropriate to give reparations to communities of Black folks who migrated to the United States on a voluntary basis. Okay. I mean, if you migrate to a racist country voluntarily, I more power to you. so that's the point. Now, you can always marry somebody who is eligible to receive reparations. And that's fine.
We will end there, but I want to ask you to join me in thanking Kristen.
Thank you.